Today in Moscow, President Vladimir Putin declared his intention to advance deeper into Ukraine and issued new threats against the West, one day after he secured his fifth term in office. It was an election with no suspense, the outcome of which was preordained. Here now is Nick Schifrin.
In Moscow tonight, a celebration and coronation. Tens of thousands in Red Square mark the 10th anniversary of Russia's illegal annexation of Crimea and the man who many call a czar. Last night, Vladimir Putin declared victory with supporters, some who weren't alive when he was appointed president in 1999. He will soon surpass Joseph Stalin to become the longest-running Russian leader since Catherine the Great.
People came to create the conditions for internal political consolidation, to move forward for development and the strengthening of their fatherland, Russia.
Putin's nearly 88% of the vote and record 77% turnout made this a Potemkin plebiscite, especially since at least one city offered voters a chance to win expensive Western electronics, and another offered motorcycles and even apartments. And Putin has launched the harshest crackdown on dissent since the Soviet Union. Putin critics say the country has moved from authoritarian to a dictatorship. But some Russian voters, especially those old enough to remember the chaos of the 1990s, say Putin symbolizes a successful effort to make Russia great again.
I am interested in what is being done now, and I would like it to be continued and even improved, because the younger generation must live in peace and harmony.
Putin's critics call that propaganda and voted with gasoline and a match, including one woman who lit her own ballot after writing, "Bring my husband back." Those who believe the ballot was already spoiled, spoiled an entire box, and others wrote in one name, Navalny. Alexei Navalny, the country's leading opposition figure before he died in mysterious circumstances in prison, had called for Russians to protest by all voting at the same time. And they showed up for noon against Putin, as seen on this video posted by Navalny's team, strength through numbers. That included expats in Berlin, where Navalny's widow, Yulia, who'd echoed her husband's protest call, waited for 6 hours to vote. For Putin, Navalny had been he who must not be named until today, when he said he was willing to include Navalny in a prisoner swap.
On one condition only, I said, so he doesn't come back. But things happen. There's nothing you can do about it.
Even before the elections, we knew that the numbers, that there should be more than 80% people vote for him.
Alexandra Prokopenko is with the Carnegie Russia Eurasia Center and was the advisor to the central bank's deputy governor before leaving to protest the Ukraine war. She says Russia's economy is unhealthy, but has avoided failure despite Western sanctions, thanks to Chinese and Indian willingness to buy Russian oil and massive military spending.
Next 12-18 months are decisive for Ukraine from the pure military standpoint. In terms of this time frame, Putin has enough money to finance the war, to continue and maintain lavish payments on population on during this timeline, and probably to keep inflation moderate.
But there is nothing moderate about Putin, who gets another turn to continue the policies that define his Russia, a nation at war with freedom and its citizens.
Joining me now is Fiona Hill. She was the senior director for European and Russian affairs on the National Security Council staff during the Trump administration. She's now a senior fellow at the Brookings Institution and the author of Mr. Putin, Operative in the Kremlin. And Evgenia Kara-Murza is advocacy director at the Free Russia Foundation, which seeks to promote a free, democratic, and peaceful Russia. Her husband, Russian opposition politician Vladimir Kara-Murza, is a political prisoner in Russia. Thanks very much. To both of you. Welcome back to the NewsHour. Evgenia Kara-Murza, let me start with you. What's your assessment of how the election went, as well as the calls for protest, the noon against Putin that we saw people in some parts of Russia, but also across the world?
Well, first of all, thank you for the invitation. And as to the election, so-called election, I don't think that this process that took part in Russia over 3 days can be called an election, because it has nothing to do with a democratic process that is called election in any normal democratic country. This was Vladimir Putin reappointing himself yet again for the fifth time as the president of the Russian Federation in violation of many international laws and having completely destroyed the Russian constitution through the so-called referendum in 2020, which basically made him into a tsar forever. So this process, I don't believe that it can be considered and accepted as a legitimate process by the international community, and I definitely call on the international community to call Vladimir Putin for who he is. He is a dictator and a usurper and a criminal, actually, wanted by the ICC. Definitely not a legitimate leader of the Russian Federation.
Fiona Hill, was this a reappointment, and is Putin a dictator?
Well, it's definitely a re-anointment, because it's not just being a dictator, but as Evgenia said, he's almost a self-styled czar at this point. And in fact, you know, these are the people that he associates himself with in Russian history. In terms of his legacy now, we're all talking about how he will be been in office longer than Catherine the Great, certainly any of the other previous czars. And if he, in fact, extends his term again beyond this current 6 year, after 2030, after 2036, he'll have been in power longer than Stalin. So I think that those legacies, even those terms, tell you enough.
Evgenia Kara-Murza, what's the point then? Why go through this stage-managed process? What is the Kremlin benefit?
Well, to create this image of universal support of the Russian population for Vladimir Putin and his policies, both domestic policies and the aggression against Ukraine. Because a lot, this regime depends a lot on this image, on this very warped image of reality. And this is why the call for the noon against Putin, because this was the only way the Russian population was able to show how many Russians were actually opposing these policies, because there are no free and fair elections. We understand that whatever we put on those ballots will be counted differently. And of course, there was no surprise in Vladimir Putin winning, maybe in a little bit in the fact that he gave himself over 87% of the vote, which is, I mean, he could be slightly more modest, but no, he had to go that high. And these results were called unprecedented and record by the Russian authorities. So the only way for Russians to actually show what they think of it was to come at the same time at noon to polling stations and see how many of us they are actually in reality.
Fiona Hill, was noon against Putin successful?
Look, I think it was symbolically very important. We'll have to see how we judge success over time. But the very fact that there was signaling that people were dissatisfied in the only way that they could, given the repressive constraints on them, is very important, because there were certainly hundreds of thousands of people. We saw hundreds of thousands of people turning out for Alexei Navalny's funeral, and not just on the day of the funeral, but on the days afterwards.
And doing so despite knowing full well
they could be arrested. Knowing that they could be arrested. And also people that turned out, in fact, to sign the forms for the possibility of an alternative candidate, Boris Nemtsov, Jezdin, to also run against Putin, who ultimately, of course, was disqualified.
Right.
But all of this is very important, because the people who have the courage to do these small acts of defiance are also standing in for, let's just say, all of the other people behind them who just don't have either the wherewithal or are too frightened, in fact, to show their dissatisfaction. So I think we can say from this that it isn't a monolith that Putin is presiding over. And it's 87% of what?
Let's turn to the future. Does Putin use 87%? Does Putin use another election to rule differently, either domestically or internationally? Fiona, I want to start with you.
Well, it's certainly going to give him confidence, and I think we're going to see him use that externally as well. It's the second year anniversary, or just there afterwards, of the full-on invasion of Ukraine. And Ukraine itself was also supposed to have an election coming up. So I would just predict right now that Putin will use the very fact that he's been re-anointed as the Tsar from here to eternity, at least his eternity, perhaps, to make the case that other elections are not being done in the same way, that there's a lack of legitimacy in Ukraine.
But he's long since questioned other elections. He's long since questioned whether there can be any democratic process anywhere. Does he use this election differently, specifically, perhaps in Ukraine or with Joe Biden? Biden as president or with the U.S. elections.
Yes, basically to make the point that we all have to deal with him and that we should be considering him and his position and the importance of Russia as an actor when we think about our own policies. So he's definitely going to use this for all he can.
Evgenia Kara-Murza, what do you think is the state of Russia's opposition today and how Putin will or will not treat it differently moving forward?
Well, the reason there is such harsh repression in the country, the reason there are these mass arrests, detentions, etc., the reason we have hundreds and hundreds of political prisoners and hundreds of thousands of Russians and being forced out of the country is because this is the alternative. Right. This is the alternative, and Vladimir Putin is doing everything to completely annihilate this alternative so that the world is left to deal with him alone. And this is why I believe it would be so important right now for the international community to do everything to show support and solidarity with those Russians who represent a vision for a different Russia, for Russia, democratic Russia, a normal country, a European country that understands and respects the freedoms and rights of its own citizens and lives in peace with its neighbors. I just understand that for as long as Vladimir Putin remains in the Kremlin, there will be warmongering and there will be repression, and those two things in Russia have always been interconnected. Internal repression always leads to external aggression, and this will go on and on for as long as this regime is allowed to survive.
But Fiona Hill, is Putin isolated internationally? It seems like he has tactical help, certainly on the battlefield, from places like North Korea and Iran. He's getting oil purchases from Iran, and there is a strategic top cover, if you will, from Beijing. How isolated is he or not, and where does he go from here?
Well, that is an issue for us to contend with. And I think it is actually a difficult one. We have to be honest about it. And it's something that we have to keep working on as well. And, you know, I think, you know, part of the problem that we always face, again, is, you know, questions about our own electoral system, which we're right in the middle of right now. Also showing, you know, insufficient, I would say, dedication and resilience when it comes to dealing with foreign policy. And the key for thinking about the answer to this question is how we basically conduct ourselves at this particular point. Now, by we,
so you think
I mean
the best
United
thing
States.
That the U.S. could do is actually strengthen itself. You think
that's right,
the...
and also strengthen its relationship with its allies and partners. And that's not just with European countries; it's also with countries like Japan, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand. There are a whole host of countries, including countries like India, that have, you know, somewhat ambiguous relationships with Russia. That we need to keep reaching out to and trying to kind of push back against the threat that Vladimir Putin poses, not just to domestically in Russia. Or to Ukraine, but to the larger world system that many other countries have benefited from. So that's a challenge for us, and Putin's thrown that challenge down. I don't think we should give up hope, because I do think that that's signalling from inside of Russia that Evgenia has talked about shows that, you know, it isn't a monolith inside of Russia, and there are vulnerabilities. And actually, he is quite isolated domestically, right? I don't think he even knows himself, you know, quite how much support he has. But people around him will know how many ballots they're stuffed. They will know how many people they bust out or forced to vote. And eventually, if he shows any kind of weakness internally, you know, there might be another reaction. We've already seen that with Prigozhin and that episode, you know, several months ago. And we've seen it with the outpouring of emotion and support for Alexei Navalny.
And Evgenia Kara-Murza, your husband, of course, has long been fighting for some of the changes that Fiona's talking about. He's in prison. How's he doing?
He's doing as well as he can. You know, he still sounds, well, sounds, I haven't talked to him since last summer, but in his letters, he is optimistic, and he sends us words of support. But that's what Russian political prisoners do, amazingly. They are the ones mistreated, they are the ones denied medical care, they are the ones in solitary confinement, and they say about Russia, about the hope for a different Russia, and about that hope living on even after the murder of Alexei Navalny. They say that Vladimir was able to address us during a recent court hearing, and it happened right after Alexei's murder. And he said that, of course, he was absolutely devastated by what had happened, and this was not the first political assassination in Russia's history. But he also said that we cannot give in to despair, because this is exactly what they want us to do, and we need to fight even more And this is what we owe to our fallen comrades, to continue the fight to make sure that Russia does become what they fought for and died for, a normal European free democratic country. So Vladimir sitting in this solitary punishment cell in Western Siberia sends us words of support and encouragement.
Evgenia Kara-Murza, Fiona Hill, thank you very much to you both.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The first